Hey, what's up guys, it's Tekosaur. Hope it's all well for you. Today I'll be reviewing a new kind of device on the channel, a mini PC that I got from AliExpress for just $150, and we're going to see how it performs across various tasks to find out if it's worth the price. The one I got is from a brand called CHUWI. It's a Chinese brand and not a very known OEM. On the back it says here it's called the LarkBox X. It comes preloaded with Windows 11. Spec wise, CPU is Intel N100, clocked at 0.8 to 3.4 GHz. GPU, Intel UHD for 12th gen. This chip is based on the Alder Lake architecture. It also supports Wi-Fi 6. As for memory, it has LPDDR5 with 12GB capacity, and that should be pretty decent for shared memory across CPU and GPU. Finally, for storage, we have a 512GB M.2 SSD. Based on this price, I'll say it has decent specs for a light computing device. Inside the box, we have this card sleeve packing stuff such as a warranty card, a product inspection report, and a user manual showing the motherboard blueprint and some info for troubleshooting. It also includes this mounting bracket if you'd like to mount the mini PC on the back of your monitor by using these 4 screws that are included. Finally, we have a power supply rated at a maximum of 36 watts, which will be more than enough to power it up. And now we'll get into the main topic. And here is the LarkBox X. At first glance, it looks quite stylish with its 2 color tones, black and white. It's pretty lightweight, being only 383 grams. You could easily fit it in your backpack, given its dimensions are 127 lengths by 127 weights and 49 mm in height. So what do we have for inputs? On the front, there are 2 USB 3 ports, 1 USB Type-C port, an audio jack, and a power button. There is also this small hole, which is for resetting the CMOS battery. While on the back, we have exhaust vents, a power connector, 2 LAN ports, HDMI 2.0, DisplayPort 1.4, and 2 additional USB 3 ports. On the side, we have a Kensington lock. On the bottom, there is this hole in the middle to mount the monitor bracket I mentioned earlier. It attaches in this way. Now we're going to check the inside to see what we have. And it's pretty simple to open. We just need to take off those 4 screws. And be careful not to lose those rubber washers. Now using a pry tool, we'll simply lift off the cover. And here we are. As you can see, we have our M.2 SSD in 2280 form factor, and they are using a Gen 3 SSD. As listed in the page, it's 512GB, and you could also swap it for a future upgrade. Now, other than this, I don't see anything notable. But if we take out the SSD, we can see that the Wi-Fi card is also made by Intel. Now, the fan and the chip are located on the top side. To access that part, we'll need to take out these 4 screws as well as those 2 located in the middle. So let's do that. Here we have the cooling fan with a compact radiator setup, and beneath it we'll find the N100 chip, and we also have the CMOS battery on the side. But unfortunately, when I took out the top cover, the Wi-Fi antenna cables got deattached by accident, so as you can see they were soldered to the top part and got disconnected. So anyway, I just soldered them back and they seem to be in place now. So if you are opening the top cover, I recommend you do it very carefully. Even though it was kind of hard to remove it, I had to give it some force, and maybe that's why they got disconnected. Anyway, let's get everything back on and test it out. So here we are in Windows. It comes preloaded with Windows 11 fully licensed Home Edition. However, it's installed as version 2020H2, which is pretty outdated in 2024. When I did all the updates, the new Windows version never showed up. So I went ahead and installed the Windows 11 Installation Assistant. By using this small tool, we can upgrade the Windows version if it's not appearing in Windows Update, as long as it's compatible. It asked to install PC Health Check to verify compatibility. Once it was installed, and it did the upgrade successfully. As you can see, now we are on version 24H2, fully updated and I also installed Intel Driver Assistant to get the latest Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and GPU drivers. Now, something that it puts me off is that the company lists that it has 4800 MTS for RAM speed, but in reality, it's running at 4000 MTS. And when we access the BIOS, there isn't literally anything to do about it. The BIOS version is from June 2023, and on the main screen, we see some hardware info, and RAM speed is set at 4000 MTS. The security tab has only basic stuff like secure boot, and the boot tab is also pretty standard. So I attempt to try out a third-party BIOS tool to see if there are hidden options by using the smokeless tool. And to my surprise, there wasn't any way to change the RAM speed. All it showed me like basic stuff like SSD info, network, and PCI settings. You can at least configure the network stack, and in the OEM extended setup configuration, there are some extra options such as auto power on, wake up LAN, and RTC wake. And these options are hidden in the original BIOS. Also in the PCI subsystem settings, resizable bar is enabled for some increased performance. So overall, we can't change the RAM speed from 4000 MTS, and it's a letdown in my opinion, being listed at 4800 MTS. Anyway, if we check the specs of the system, we can see the CPU is as advertised. Intel N100 with 4 cores and a maximum TDP of 6 watt, based on the Arrow Lake architecture at 10 nanometer node. The main board is by CHUWI and supports up to PCI Gen 3. So using a Gen 4 SSD won't provide any benefits. In the memory tab, we can see the RAM speed and timings. It's DDR5 dual channel and manufactured by Samsung. By verifying everything, it matches what the company listed, except for the RAM speed being 4000 instead of 4800 MTS, with no way to change it either in BIOS or elsewhere. Aside from this, everything is fully accurate. Now this PC is naturally built for light tasks like office work, small server setup, media streaming, or a small compact high mobile PC. It's not a powerhouse PC, but let's see how it stacks up in some performance tests to at least check its cooling and fan noise and whether there are any performance related issues. I've run Cinebench R23 multi-core and single core, and our scores are for multi-core 2943, while for single core 896. Our max core temp was 79 degrees Celsius with no indication of thermal throttling, and that's awesome, with max core ratio at 3.4 GHz, meaning it's able to boost clock just fine. Max power consumption is 15 watt, and even with Cinebench test running, the exterior temp stayed relatively cool, with a max hotspot of 44.7 degrees. It's also very, very quiet. I could barely hear the fan noise during the benchmark. So I'd say it's doing pretty good job for cooling. Now, how about the GPU? Of course, this one packs Intel older UHD GPUs, so it's not from the Arc lineup, so therefore we can't expect top tier performance. By running 3DMark Steel Nomad Lite test, we scored 247 points, which is telling us it's among the best for this chip. The average is 239 and the best is 249. So this is an awesome performance for this chip. And running Time Spy, we got for GPU score 326, while for CPU 2442, for a total of 374, higher than the average, giving us an excellent grade. The GPU part is holding the performance back, but the CPU seems quite decent. For real gaming, here is what you can expect at 1080p with low settings. In GTA 5, the performance is around 30fps with occasional fluctuations, slightly higher or lower. Both the CPU and GPU are running at full usage, but temps are quite okay, hovering around 70 degrees. Power consumption max out at 15 watt. While it's not the smoothest gaming experience, it's impressive that this game runs at all on this hardware. PS2, on the other hand, offers slightly lower performance, with FPS ranging between 15 to 25. It's playable for casual use, but far from ideal for competitive gaming. Some titles like No Rest for the Wicked didn't work at all. All I got was a red and black screen, so clearly, this isn't a machine built to run all games out there. However, lighter games perform much better, like Hades 2 run relatively well, delivering a steady 35 to 40 FPS with no major stutters or performance hiccups. I found it perfectly playable. I also tried Sifu, and it ran decently at around 30 FPS for most of the time. Even Genshin Impact managed to hold steady at 30 FPS. As for retro or way less demanding titles, this mini PC really shines. You can expect optimal performance, with FPS exceeding 70 in many cases. So while this isn't a gaming machine by any means, it does handle older and lighter games quite well for its size and price point. So overall, I believe the CHUWI LarkBox X mini PC is a cheap option for anyone looking for a portable, compact PC for specific tasks. While it's not designed for gaming enthusiasts, it gets the job done for light everyday computing. At just $150, it's a considerable deal. I picked it up on AliExpress, where they have offering super deals with discounts of up to 70%, so it's definitely worth checking it out if you are in the market for a cheap mini PC. Finally, I'd love to hear your thoughts about it. Do you have any questions about this mini PC? And would you like to see more mini PCs reviews on this channel? Let me know in the comments below. And if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to give it a like and subscribe to TechoSaur for more reviews and techie content. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Peace out.